A severe flaw was found in a RealTek SDK, national cybersecurity initiatives happen at a government meeting, and that Razer privilege escalation flaw? Yeah, that works on other devices too. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse and this is ThreatWire for August 31st, 2021. This is your weekly summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. We have some awesome 0 days to get into today, so right on to the news. Hey, Mirai is back. Well, sort of, it just keeps on going. And it's targeting a lot of devices that use RealTek chipsets and a RealTek SDK. This affects lots of Wi-Fi routers and connected products from several different popular vendors, including Belkin, Netgear, Logitech, Asus, D-Link, and more. Over 200 products from 65 different vendors are affected, which means that this could be an issue for hundreds of thousands of products currently in use today. The CVE is 2021-35395, and it is high severity, given it affects anything from routers to gateways to IP cameras, smart light hubs, and kids' connected toys. This is an RCE, allowing for remote code execution, so an attacker could potentially gain access to the management interface for devices and run whatever code they deem fit. The RealTek flaw is a supply chain problem, as it affects so many devices made by so many different OEMs. RealTek did patch this on August 13th, which was just 3 days before it went public, so chances are there's a lot of vulnerable devices that have not been updated yet, given OEMs need to distribute those patches. And a Mirai botnet is already taking advantage of this vulnerability. It was found to be scanning the internet for unpatched devices on August 18th, according to security company SAM Seamless Network. Now, this same botnet is scanning for an authentication bypass vulnerability as well, tracked as CVE 2021-20090, which impacts devices with the Arcadian firmware. Given the attackers behind this botnet started doing a bunch of scanning back in early 2021, around February, it's likely they are actively looking for vulnerabilities to exploit constantly. National cybersecurity has been a major concern for the past several years, so last week, US President Joe Biden met with many CEOs of tech companies to discuss cybersecurity initiatives. Business heads like Apple CEO Tim Cook and Google CEO Sundar Pichai were in attendance. Also included were leaders from Amazon, ADP, JP Morgan Chase, ConocoPhillips, Microsoft, IBM, and more. The goal of this meeting was to find ways that the private sector could work with the government to improve national cybersecurity through critical infrastructure, the cybersecurity workforce, and strengthening the industry as a whole. The companies in attendance did offer to make improvements. For example, Google promised to invest $10 billion over 5 years into CyberSec, focusing on supply chain and open source, training 100,000 Americans in tech support and data analytics via their Google Career Certificate Program, and training 10 million Americans in basic to advanced digital skills by 2023. IBM plans to also train 150,000 people for cybersecurity skills and partner with historically black colleges and universities to grow a more diverse workforce. Amazon will be offering free MFA devices to qualified AWS customers, along with offering free materials for cybersecurity training called Amazon Security Awareness. Microsoft promised to invest $20 billion in security solutions over the next 5 years and $150 million to help US agencies, along with expanding cybersecurity training partnerships. And the National Institute of Standards and Technology also announced that they will be working with industry partners to create a framework to improve the security of the technological supply chain. Several other industry organizations, such as Girls Who Code, Resilience, and more, also announced their own initiatives. This meeting follows several initiatives that are already put in place earlier this year by the Biden administration, such as a 100-day cybersecurity improvement initiative for the electric sector, which was just expanded to include natural gas pipelines starting in spring. And then in May, President Biden signed an executive order to modernize government defenses and improve security technology. Then in July, President Biden issued a national security memorandum establishing voluntary CyberSec goals for critical infrastructure. The administration has also worked internationally to update NATO cyber policies, the first time that's happened in 7 years, and hold nations accountable if they harbor cyber criminals who are behind ransomware. We will likely see a lot of these initiatives happen over the course of several years, not immediately. I love it when y'all send me these adorable pictures of your pets, so these are a few from my Hush Puppy Patreon Alliance members. And also thank you so much to Aubrey and Roy for joining the Alliance. Patrons are starting to receive their new merch rewards in the mail. A lot of folks have received their mugs and their stickers depending on your perk level. You can always sign up at any time to access those perks as well. Patreon.com/ThreatWire as always for that, and onto the third news story. Now, to follow up with the Razer Windows 10 zero-day story from last week, remember how we were thinking aloud that this could affect other devices too, not just Razer products, because so many devices bundle some kind of software installer whenever you plug them in? Well, in the Razer product case, you just plug a Razer peripheral in, and it prompts to download and install the Synapse software from Razer, which also happens to execute as system, allowing for an elevated PowerShell to be exploited and code to be ran. Now, the security researcher was offered a bounty, and Razer stated that they will be releasing a patch. Now, a second researcher named Lawrence Ammer found a privileged escalation vulnerability in Steelseries peripherals that allows for the same thing. Steelseries also responded and changed their installation process. Microsoft responded saying, "We are investigating and this requires physical access." Okay, that's great, but and disclaimer, because Hack5 does sell these in the Hack5 shop and they manufacture these, you could do the same thing without a peripheral using a Bash Bunny or an OMG cable. So according to MG, you can do this by spoofing the vulnerable device's USB ID, the VID or the PID, of which there could potentially be 2,500 possibly exploitable devices. So yeah, the Hack5 crew was having a good time with this one. As for consumers, minimize physical access to your machine and do not plug random peripherals or cables into them, which you shouldn't be doing anyways. Just to mention. Now that the studio is finished, I am back to filming content at youtube.com/Shannon Morse, just like my name is spelled. Hit the subscribe button on that channel to see my upcoming review of the Pixel 5a 5G, along with, and I'm so excited about these, the new Samsung foldables. Yeah, I got both of them. I know, I'm crazy. There is no ThreatWire episode next week since my recording day falls on Labor Day, so I will see you back here on the 14th. Don't forget to like and subscribe as well to this channel. I'm Shannon Morse, and I will see you on the internet.